Good morning, everyone. Come on, let's all stand to our feet. Feel free to move up and move in to make room for others. And just hope that you all are ready to worship together this morning. Following a star in the sky, carrying our gifts through the night. A child has been born, a child has been born. Angels break the silence with joy. Love has come to fill every void. A child has been born, a child has been born. Jesus, we sing glory in the highest. Heaven and earth collide, welcoming the King of Kings. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus, everything defeated. Welcoming the Prince of Peace, our Prince of Peace. Fall on their knees, surrendering to your majesty. Worthy is your name, worthy is your name. Every crown we lay at your feet, Savior, you're the light that we need. Worthy is your name, worthy is your name. Savior, Messiah, Emmanuel. Our Father forever, our mighty defender, oh Jesus, holy Jesus. Our wonderful counselor, our Savior, Messiah.
Of peace, we sing glory in the highest, heaven and earth collide. joy to the world.
Joy to the world on a night like no other. Emmanuel, God is with us. Beggars and kings, let us come and adore Him. Rest in His peace and bow before Him. Sing, all you people, the Lord Almighty reigns. Sing, every creature of God, come bless His name.
Justice through to victory. In His name, the nations will put their hope.
This week begins Advent. The word Advent comes from the Latin word Adventus, meaning coming. This week we light the first candle of the Advent, which symbolizes hope. This is also known as the prophecy candle. We light the purple candle to remind ourselves of the hope that we have in Jesus.
Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. that's our prayer today, is that Jesus will be lifted high, and that wherever you are in your life, in your faith journey, that you will encounter him in a fresh way today. Would you go ahead and be seated? And welcome. I'm so glad you're here on this Sunday after Thanksgiving. My name's Greg. I'm one of our pastors here at Christ Church. I just want to say a special welcome to you. I'm so glad that you're here today. If this is your first time, a special welcome to you. The easiest way to connect at Christ Church is to take out your phone, and on the chair in front of you, there's a little tag, and you just tap it with your phone, and it'll bring up a screen, and it just says get connected. You can fill out some basic information there, and we would love to come alongside of you and help you through life and help you through this thing, your faith journey. You can't do life alone, and so we would love to partner with you. There's also an opportunity there. If you have a prayer request, something that you would love us to partner with you, come alongside of you and pray with you and for you, we'd be honored to do that as well. And really, the first step to connecting here at Christ Church, we talk about it all the time, it's Starting Point. We're going to be hosting that in a couple of Sundays. And so you can sign up there online, or you can see someone in our orange shirt, and we'd be happy. We'd love to get you connected. Now, we're rolling into Christmas. Thanksgiving's over. And December is coming this week. And the thing about the Christmas season, it's a season of, it's fun. There's lights, there's joy, there's great movies, there's a lot of things, but it's also a time when people struggle. When things in your life get magnified during the Christmas season. And so if things are going really well, it gets magnified. If there's struggles in your life, it gets magnified. And so a few things that we're doing during this Christmas season to help shine the good news, the gospel, the light of Jesus in our city. There's a couple things we're doing. The first is we're hosting Christmas services here at Christ Church. In fact, if you didn't get it on your way in, you can grab some cards on your way out. It has all the information. We'll be gathering in this room on the 23rd and the 24th with our Christmas services, and we're just going to share the hope that is found in Jesus Christ. And so I want to encourage you, grab a stack of these for your coworkers, for your family, for your neighbors. We're going to have a great time celebrating in here with Christmas. Also, Christmas is the time where we're going to try to come alongside families in our area who are struggling with limited resources. And we've created this thing called Christmas Shop, and we're kind of getting to the end where we got to get this going, is we're setting up shops around Jacksonville where families who are struggling financially can have a dignified way where they can come and purchase gifts, toys, for their family at a very discounted cost. And again, our goal this year is over 13,000 toys for over 2,000 kids. And we're getting to the end because the first shops are starting next week, and we need to get those fully stocked, and we need a few more toys. So some of you, if you're on our email list, you got an email this week, you can click on that link, and it takes you to Amazon, and you can order it, and it's real simple because it just gets delivered here. And we can take it and get it to the proper shop. Or if you didn't get the email, I would encourage you at the end of our service, go out these doors and over here to our atrium, and where you see the TVs and the Christmas trees and the toys, there'll be a team there that would love to give you information how you, your family, your small group, maybe just a tennis group or a hangout group, can come alongside and help give kids, give families in our area who are struggling a little boost this Christmas in the name of Jesus. Now, we're going to kick off a new series this Sunday called He Shall Be Called. This is our Christmas series. Jeremy's going to be out here in a minute. Before he comes, can I just pray over you? And God, I thank you for every single one in this room. I don't believe in chance or fate or luck. God, I believe that you've divinely orchestrated the people that you want to be here on this nasty, rainy Sunday. And so, God, I pray you'll open eyes. I pray you'll open ears. I pray your words would just leap off the page and not just go into our minds, but penetrate even into our soul. So, God, have your way in this moment. Help us to encounter and experience you in a fresh way today. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Morning, church. How we doing? Everybody good? Surviving the rain? Yeah? Good. My name is Jeremy. I'm on the team here. Super excited to hang out with you guys, talk about Jesus a little bit today. Again, hope you guys had a great Thanksgiving. Hopefully you got some food, some time with family. But I've been waiting since Thursday to get this off my chest, okay? I just need you to meet me here, and we just all acknowledge. Everybody says Thanksgiving food is great, and everybody acts like we love it, but then you don't make it for a year, okay? So how much do you really love it? Let's just be honest. Like, you don't make, I don't know, maybe you do, but there's no green bean casserole in May, okay? You know, there's no stuffing or dressing or whatever you call it on a Tuesday in February, right? Like, can we just, like call it a day and make steak and McDonald's French fries a new Thanksgiving tradition? Like, can that just be what it is? Like, turkey's not even that good, people, okay? Like, let's be real. Anyway, well, if you didn't know, Thanksgiving's over, which means Christmas is next week. Or at least feels like it every year. It's coming, and it's coming fast. So we are jumping in here at Christ Church right back into Christmas season. We're actually starting today, brand new series, He Shall Be Called. And what we're going to do over the next, I guess, 4 weeks is we're going to kind of zoom in on a different title that Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 gives the coming Messiah. We know as Jesus today, but a couple titles are given, and it kind of flows right in. We've been in Genesis, the book of Genesis now for like a year. We're going to wrap that up in this spring. Super excited for that as we look at Joseph's life. But we've kind of been noticing over the last like few months and stuff in Genesis that these names keep being given to God. Like, God will do something or he'll move in some way, and someone gives God a name. Like, the God is the God who does whatever, or sees whatever, or is powerful in a certain kind of way. And there's these names for God that keep popping out throughout the text. And so that is true also in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, when four like titles, kind of like adjectives, get given of who will someday be the coming Messiah. And those titles are that the coming Messiah will be a wonderful counselor, he'll be a mighty God, he'll be an everlasting father, and he'll be the Prince of Peace. Those are the titles. And so each week, over the next 4 weeks, we're kind of going to zoom in on one of those titles and talk about how they are reflected in Jesus and what they mean for our lives today. So today we're going to be talking about how the coming Messiah, how Jesus is a wonderful counselor. So what we're going to do is we're going to jump in first to Isaiah chapter 9, then we're going to actually end up in John chapter 4 in a pretty famous passage. Then we're going to talk about Disney's Moana, because I have a 7 and 5-year-old and that's where I live, okay? And then we're going to jump back into Isaiah chapter 9. Sound good? Cool. All right. So first, we got to talk about counseling in general, okay? Like the title counseling. Now, I'm not a licensed counselor. I've never taken any kind of a class on counseling necessarily. But in ministry, for the last 12, 13 years of my adult life, continually find myself in like counseling kind of situations. Now, I'm pro counseling. I'm always pushing them to people that actually know what they're talking about. But people will frequently end up in my office or at coffee or something. For most of my life, the backdrop of that has been kids and teenagers and their parents or other kid-adjacent adults, if you will. It's been some combination of those people who, on a weekly basis, will reach out for help. And so they'll end up in my office. And I got to tell you, early on in my like early 20s, 22, 23, I thought that counseling was just telling them what they needed to do. Okay? So like, somebody would come into my office, this would happen on a frequent basis, they would start telling me about the trauma in their past, or the addiction they're wrestling with, or the relationship struggles that they've been going through, and I would, you know, tune them out after 30 seconds, right? Like, I'd heard the problem, and I had already in my mind decided what the solution was to the problem, and borderline, I wasn't quite this bad, but borderline, like, slide them a list of directions across the table and say, okay, I hear your problem. Now, all you got to do is this, 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 and this. You'll be better in 7 to 10 days. Right? Like that, I thought that counseling was like just good advice. I thought that's all that counseling was. And so I got to a point where people kept coming in my office and I just kept sending them home with all the right answers, clearly, right? And at some point I started to think, you know, like, man, these people keep coming in, but they're throwing me softballs, man. I'm like Barry Bonds, just like knocking these puppies out of the park. One, I guess, minus the steroids plus the Holy Spirit, Barry Bonds, if you will. But anyway, so like I felt like I had all the right answers, but then you know what happened? A couple months later, the same people kept ending up back in my office. It's more than 7 to 10 days. This should be cured by now. So quickly, I started to realize that that was a them problem. Clearly, I had given all the right answers, right? So certainly, it couldn't have been me that was the issue. But obviously, as time goes on, you start to realize that I guess good advice and wisdom is a part of counseling, but it's not the whole package. And so, I just need to say right off the bat that when we talk about how Jesus is a wonderful counselor, we are not talking about, not like Jeremy, Jesus actually has all the answers to all the questions ever, right? Romans 11, for him and through him and by him, everything was made. Like, he is the author of creation. So he's got the answers. I actually didn't have a clue what I was talking about. But Jesus is a different kind of counselor. He doesn't just give answers. He's growing. He's stretching. He's guiding. He's leading. He's not just handing you the playbook, because I think he knows that if he just gave us all the answers, we wouldn't actually believe it. He helps us work through it. He's connecting our head to our hearts, our decisions to our desires. When we talk about him being a wonderful counselor, it's way more than just good advice. Now, we're going to pick it up in Isaiah chapter 9, but actually, Isaiah chapter 8, context always matters, right? Like, we need to make sure we understand the context of the ending of Isaiah chapter 8. The last verse, actually, in Isaiah chapter 8, don't take my word for this, I'm not quoting here, but the last verse is talking about a season in the life of God's people that is full of darkness, distress, despair, depression. It's bad right now for God's people. Like, that is the context to which chapter 9 starts. In fact, most scholars would actually say that we've misplaced the chapter marker, that the first verse in chapter 9 should actually still be a part of the end of chapter 8. So the context to which Isaiah 9 verse 1 comes in is that it is bad for God's people right now. There is war. There is disease, there is depression, anxiety, there is slavery, there is chaos, there is relationship struggles, there is weight on their shoulders that they don't know how to get off. Sound like 2023 enough? Right? There's chaos in their world. There is darkness and pain and suffering in their world. Then Isaiah chapter 9, verse 1, that's actually a part of that same thought. Isaiah says, Nevertheless, that time of darkness and despair will not go on forever. The land of Zebulun and Naphtali will be humbled, but there will be a time in the future when Galilee of the Gentiles, which lies along the road that runs between the Jordan and the sea, will be filled with glory. Can you imagine the collective sigh of relief for God's people in that moment? In the middle of the darkness, in the middle of the chaos, in the middle of the despair, nevertheless, a time is coming that this darkness won't last forever. For the first time, there's light at the end of the tunnel. For the first time, there's hope. For the first time, there's peace. Now, the text acknowledges that it's not necessarily going to be easy. Isaiah specifically says, Zebulun and Naphtali, it's still going to be tough for a minute. Zebulun and Naphtali were actually, in the history of God's people, they were the first two groups to take their eyes off of God and start worshiping other false gods. And in doing so, they ended up in slavery before everybody else. So it has been the darkest, the longest for Zebulun and Naphtali. And so right off the bat, he's saying, it's not going to get easy right off the bat. But one day, a light is going to shine in Galilee. We know his name is Jesus, right? But I love the collective sigh of relief for God's people that somebody sees our pain, somebody hears our cries, somebody notices what we're going through, the chaos, the war, the slavery, the oppression, the fear, the guilt, the shame, the regret, the fear of the present and of the future. It's all weighing on their shoulders. And Isaiah says, but it's not going to last forever. Now, I want to do something a little bit different here, but before we do it, I need you to go ahead and get in your mind, like in your mind's eye, so to speak. I need you to picture the last time in your life, which could be right now. I need you to picture the last time in your life when you were living in an Isaiah chapter 8 kind of season. You know what I'm saying? Like, I need you to picture in your mind the last time there was chaos swirling around you, or shame of the past, or fear of the future. The last time that war or disease or darkness was swirling around you. Maybe you didn't know what was next. You couldn't figure out what was going on. There's chaos in your relationships, chaos in your home. That there's darkness and despair all around. I need you to, before we do this, I need you to find in your mind the last time. It could be right now. There could be chaos going on in your life as we speak. It could be shame of the past, fear of the future, chaos even in the present right now in your life. But I need you to at least go back to the last time you had those feelings or had those emotions. And what I want to do is I actually want to read this text to you. It'll probably be on the screens, but I don't want you to read along with me. I want you to hear what Isaiah is promising is coming in the Messiah. So humor me for a second, if you will. Actually, if you don't mind, just everybody put like both feet flat on the ground for a second. Set down your Bible for a second even. Maybe just stare at the floor for a second. Close your eyes for a moment. I want you to hear the words of Isaiah and the promise of the coming Messiah in light of your Isaiah chapter 8 personal season of your Isaiah chapter 8 kind of moment in your life. So just hear these words just for a moment. This is Isaiah chapter 9. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in a land of deep darkness, a light will shine. You will enlarge the nation of Israel, and its people will rejoice. They will rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest and like warriors dividing the plunder. For you will break the yoke of their slavery and lift the heavy burden from their shoulders. You will break the oppressor's rod, just as you did when you destroyed the army of Midian. The boots of the warrior and uniforms bloodstained by war will all be burned. They will be fuel for the fire. For a child is born to us. A son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His government and its peace will never end. He will rule with fairness and justice from the throne of his ancestor David for all eternity. The passionate commitment of the Lord of Heaven's armies will make this happen. Yeah. Like, can you imagine for God's people the sigh of relief in that moment? Maybe I just got more counseling from reading that passage myself than I ever gave anyone in my early 20s. Can you imagine the collective sigh of relief from God's people as they hear, it's still bad right now, it's not just magically better, but can you imagine the knowledge that one day this war is gonna be over? We're not even gonna need our uniforms to go to battle anymore because the war is gonna be over. And the weight that feels on that is on my shoulders right now is gonna be lifted, and the darkness is gonna disperse at the light, and the chaos and the anxiety and the disease will not last forever. Can you even imagine just a glimmer of hope? The possibility of peace. I hope you can, because I hope you heard God's words in light of your Isaiah chapter 8 season right now. But I also love, I love that Isaiah kind of signs this. It's like he puts the John Hancock on the end of this by saying, the Lord of Heaven's armies has said it, so you can believe it. And I love that. I love that title, The Lord of Heaven's Armies. I did a little homework, and I found out the title Lord of Heaven's Armies is all over the Old Testament. It's like another name given to God, that he is the Lord of Heaven's Armies. But I love that the first time it pops up is in the book 1 Samuel, which, if you're a Bible nerd at all, you know 1 Samuel is kind of the beginning of when God gives a physical king to his people. And so, like, God gives his people King Saul for the first time, then David, then Solomon, and then it gets dicey after that. But God gives them a physical king, and then he calls himself the Lord of Heaven's armies. I think it was God's way of saying, okay, here's your king, but don't forget how big my biceps are. You know what I'm saying? Like, hey, I'm going to give you a little bitty ruler, but don't forget I'm strapped with millions of angels at my disposal. So don't forget who the real king is. And so in other words, Isaiah comes in, he says, the Lord of Heaven's armies has said that this will not last forever, so you can take it to the bank. This is not going to end in darkness. It honestly, it reminds me of Space Jam. because everything really reminds me of Space Jam, but it reminds me of a scene, like in a movie, if you will, here with me. It reminds me of a scene in a movie when it's dark, when it's bad, when the Monstars are whooping the Looney Tunes, okay? It's bad, there's no hope, everybody's broken, everybody's bruised, the war is about to be over, they're about to be slaves to the Monstars until Michael Jordan's shoes hit the floor. Now, for the first time, there's hope. Now, for the first time, so you're telling me there's a chance now? Like, now, for the first time, there's a possibility that this won't end. And it reminds me kind of The Lion King, when Simba returns to the Pride Lands to find them in utter darkness and despair, but then the other lions hear his roar for the first time. Because as long as the king is alive, there's hope. As long as the king is alive, there's a possibility of peace. And all the other lions take courage to go to fight when they haven't been willing to fight until now. But when the king arrives, now they're ready to go to work. Feels like that for God's people. It kind of feels like Tom Cruise in the latest Top Gun. Bet you saw that one coming today in the message, didn't you? Like, it feels like when Tom Cruise in the newest Top Gun, he's been trying to train these pilots to fly an impossible mission, and they're discouraged, they're beaten, they're broken, they don't think it's possible, and they think it's going to be the end of their lives to go on this mission until Tom Cruise steals a multi-million-dollar jet and proves to all of them that the impossible mission is possible, and then they all stand up and they rally behind him to go fight. Kind of reminds me, if you can remember 20 years ago, to Lord of the Rings, when the armies of Mordor and all the orcs are coming bearing down on the only few good guys left, but Aragorn, the king of Gondor, pulls his sword and says, essentially, it's time to go to work, guys. And the whole crew rallies behind him and follows him into battle, because when the king pulls out his sword, there is hope. As long as the king is alive, there's a possibility that this darkness won't last. That feels like a movie moment to God's people. They've been living in the darkness of the Pride Lands with Scar ruling over them. They've been living in the chaos of the ruling of the Monstars, of the fear of the war, or the chaos swirling around them. And then out of nowhere, God comes in, the Lord of Heaven's armies, and he says, I got this, y'all. Can you imagine the collective sigh of relief for God's people in knowing the Lord of Heaven's armies, the king is alive, and he's about to go to work? But if we can, just for a second, I want to zoom in on that title, Wonderful Counselor. I nerded out a little bit on this over the last couple weeks, and actually most scholars would say that there should be a comma between the word wonderful and counselor in Isaiah 9:6, like essentially the Messiah, that Jesus will be wonderful and he'll be a counselor. Not that those two should go together, like that he is standalone wonderful and he's standalone a counselor. Call me naive, but I feel like if you're wonderful and a counselor, you're also a wonderful counselor. I don't know that necessarily is that significant of a difference, but I did find one thing that I thought was pretty cool. I actually found that the wonderful is a appropriate translation into English, but it doesn't really carry the full weight of it, because it's a hard translation. The actual Hebrew word for wonderful is better just translated the root word wonder. So I think actually a better title, rather than Wonderful Counselor, would be more like Wonder of a Counselor. Like that Jesus is this unimaginably, unexplainably great kind of counselor. Like, I've been to premarital counseling, I've been to marriage counseling, I've been to personal counseling. I am pro-counseling at every turn. If you are living in an Isaiah chapter 8 kind of season in your life right now, seek out counseling. There are a lot of good counselors out there, but Isaiah's saying, you ain't never seen one like this guy. Like, this guy's different. Like, this guy's a whole other level kind of counselor. You couldn't even imagine what this guy can do. And so God's people, they want out of the chaos, they want out of the darkness, but they don't know where to turn until the promise that one day a wonder of a counselor is coming. He knows where you've been, he knows where you are, and he knows how to lead you home. They want out of the suffering, they want out of the pain, they want out of the relational trauma, the anxiety, the depression, but they don't know how to get out of it. They're trapped, they're stuck, they feel like they just keep running into walls and closed doors, but one day a wonder, an unimaginably great. He knows all the answers, and yet he's going to grow you. He's going to guide you. He's going to lead you. He's going to be inside your chest. He's going to be your spiritual, relational, emotional strength trainer. He's going to connect your head to your heart and vice versa. He's going to connect your decisions to your desires, and he's going to mold you and make you into who he created you to be. Can you imagine the sigh of relief for God's people in the promise that one day a wonder of a counselor is coming? And they hear the rumblings of the roar of the lion. They hear the sound of the sword being pulled out, the sneakers hitting the floor, and they know, if they haven't known in a long time, that the king is here and he's going to take us home. Actually, what I want to do is I want to jump into John chapter 4. John chapter 4, super famous passage in the Bible. If you've grown up in church at all, you could probably just quote this section of scripture probably. We don't even have time. I wish it's a monumental text. I wish we had time to dive into it all the way. But what I actually want to do is I want to look at John chapter 4 in light of Jesus being a wonder of a counselor. Isaiah predicted that one day a wonder of a counselor would come. In John chapter 4, he has come, but I want you to see him at work. I want to read John chapter 4, looking at it through the lens of Jesus being a wonder of a counselor, and I'd love for us almost to put ourselves in the seat of this woman at a well and like let Jesus lead us through our Isaiah chapter 8 season, just like he's going to do with this woman at the well. So John chapter 4, we're going to pick it up in verse 5. Watch how Jesus counsels this woman. Eventually, Jesus came to the Samaritan village of Sychar, near the field that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired from the long walk, sat wearily beside the well about noontime. Soon a Samaritan woman came to draw water and said to Jesus, "Please give me a drink." He was alone at the time because the disciples had gone into the village to buy some food. The woman was surprised, for Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaritans. She said to Jesus, "You're a Jew, and I'm a Samaritan woman. Why are you asking me for a drink?" Which we know, this is like a 500 to 1,000-year-old rivalry between Jews and Samaritans. So this woman is right in saying, "Dude, what are you talking to me for? Like, you're a Jewish guy. I'm like a Samaritan woman. Like, none of this adds up." But hold on, lady. You don't understand yet. You're about to find out that Jesus is a wonder of a counselor. Have you ever tried to, did you know this? You have to schedule counseling appointments, and it might take you right now 6 weeks to get one, and then you got to do all the financial stuff, then you got to do all the paperwork. I am pro counseling, but by golly, you have to work to get counseling. This lady is living in her Isaiah chapter 8 moment, and the counseling comes to her. Jesus seeks her out. Do you know any counselors that say, "Hey, I know work's been really bad lately. I know you just got that report from your boss, and I heard about the sickness in your family. You need to come in and talk to me." That doesn't happen. That's not a thing. Counselors don't come to you. You have to seek them out. But this guy is a wonder of a counselor. And he knows this woman is living in her Isaiah chapter 8 moment, and he finds her. That's crazy. That's a different kind of counselor. Pick it up, verse 10. Jesus replied, "If you only knew the gift God has for you and who you're speaking to, you would ask me, and I would give you living water." If you only knew here, like, he's the Lord of heaven's armies. Lady, if you even had a clue who you're talking to right now. "But sir, you don't have a rope or a bucket," she said, "and this well is very deep. Where would you get this living water? And besides, do you think you're greater than our ancestor Jacob?" Yeah, a little bit, I do think, actually. "Do you think you're better than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us this well? How can you offer better water than he and his sons and his animals enjoyed?" Again, Romans 11, "For by him and for him and through him, everything has been made." Jesus has every answer to every question in all of history. And he has the power and he has the ability to just hand this lady, like 22-year-old Jeremy thought he was doing, like hand this lady, just go do this, 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 and your problems would be solved. He has the power to chart that course, to know the way. But I think he knows that if he just revealed it all to her right now, she wouldn't believe it, she wouldn't get it, and this would all be a waste. What he does is he guides her. He uses water, they're sitting at a well, as an example of what it might look like to give your life to Jesus. And now she's still confused, but he's guiding her. He's growing her. He's leading her. Yes, in your Isaiah chapter 8 moment, Jesus has all the answers, but he doesn't always just reveal them to you all at once. Sometimes he has to grow you. Sometimes he has to lead you through the chaos so that you'll trust in him. Pick it up, verse 13. Jesus replied, "Anyone who drinks this water," I imagine him like pointing at the well, "anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again. But those who drink the water I give them will never thirst again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life." "Please, sir," the woman said, "I want some of that water. Then I'll never be thirsty again, and I won't have to keep coming here to get water." Do you just see the immediately even the anxiety that this woman is bringing? She's like, "I'm stuck in my rut. I'm doing the same thing all the time, and I'm just tired of running into walls. I'm tired of shut doors. If you've got a better way, I'm actually in for that." All of a sudden, Jesus has her attention. All of a sudden, he's leaned in enough that now she's like, "Hold on, okay. If you actually got something worth buying, I'd be willing to give that a go." Then this is funny. This is where it gets dicey. Verse 16, "Go and get your husband," Jesus told her. "I don't have a husband," the woman replied. Jesus said, "You're right. You don't have a husband. For you have had 5 husbands, and you aren't even married to the man you're living with. You certainly spoke the truth." Can you imagine this lady picking her jaw up off the edge of the well? Like, "Hold up, wait, what'd you say your name was? Oh, yeah, sorry, I'm about to tell you in a second, but I'm actually the Lord of Heaven's armies. I kind of got this whole thing under my, like, umbrella here. And so, like, I know way more about you." But do you see in this one moment how in one statement he removes the shame of her past, he cancels out the chaos of her present, that she's living with somebody that's not really committed to her, and so there's tons of fear there, and the unknown of the future, he just wipes it all clean in one statement. He is a wonder of a counselor. He cleans the table right there. Verse 19, "Sir," the woman said, "you must be a prophet." almost. Verse 25, the woman said, "I know the Messiah is coming." Yeah, he sure is, lady. "The one who is called Christ. When he comes, he's going to explain everything to us," because he's going to be a wonder of a counselor. She knows that one day a wonder of a counselor is coming, and he's going to make sense of it. Then Jesus told her. By the way, this is for the very first time. Jesus hasn't said these words to anybody. Not the rabbis or the religious elite, not his 12 disciples haven't even heard him say this. To a Samaritan woman at a well, living in her Isaiah chapter 8 moment, the counselor seeks her out and reveals this to her. "I am the Messiah." The Bible just decides to not record her reaction for some reason. I don't know what the deal is there, but anyway, thanks, John. Verse 27, "Just then his disciples came back. They were shocked to find him talking to a woman. But none of them had the nerve to ask, what do you want with her? Or why are you talking to her?" The woman left her water jar beside the well. She left the water. I think that's a cool note. She left the physical water, took the living water. She left the water jar beside the well and ran back to the village telling everyone, "Come and see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this guy possibly be the Messiah?" So the people came streaming from the village to see him. This is crazy to me. I bet it wouldn't even be an exaggeration to say I've read this passage 100 times in my life, and I've never noticed this. About 6 months ago, I was at a conference, and a pastor named Albert Tate was going through this passage, and he mentioned something I'd never seen before. The 12 disciples had gone into the village to buy food. They'd gone to the Sychar Walmart to get some snacks, okay? And they come back from the Sychar Walmart to where Jesus is meeting with this woman, and they come back with their Cheetos, right? So Peter and James and John are just snacking in the corner. This woman has one encounter with the wonder of a counselor. She goes back to that village, brings all the people, not snacks, brings all the people to meet Jesus. The 12 disciples, the greatest missionaries the world has ever known, were just in that village and didn't bring even potato chips for Jesus. This woman goes into town, brings everybody, says, "Could this really be the guy? Could this really be, come meet the guy who gave me more counseling in one conversation than I could even imagine. Come meet the guy who removed the shame of my past who walked through the chaos of my present and gave me a hope and a future that this darkness will not be the end. Here's a few other passages about how Jesus is a wonder of a counselor that I see play out in John chapter 4. Isaiah 65, 24. I will answer them before they even call to me. While they are still talking about their needs, I will go ahead and answer their prayers. That's what he does for this woman. She didn't even have a question, and Jesus answered it anyway. She didn't call and set up a Lord of Heaven's Armies counseling appointment. Jesus found her and met her in her Isaiah chapter 8 moment, and he's doing it for us too. Even though you can't see him, even though you don't know, he's already working behind the scenes, even when you haven't called out to him. 1 Peter 5, 7, give all your worries and cares to God because he cares about you. Do you see how he did that for this woman? He met with her. He listened to her. He cared for her. He canceled the shame of her past, gave her hope for a future. He's doing that for you as well. And then finally, Jeremiah 33, 3, ask me and I will tell you remarkable secrets you do not know about things to come. Sometimes Jesus just opens the curtain just enough so that you can see that there is hope, that you can see that there's a possibility of a future, that you can see the light at the end of the tunnel, that the Lord of Heaven's armies has declared it, and he will make good on his promise that nevertheless, this time of darkness will come to an end. Might not be easy, might be hard for a while, but it's gonna come to an end. In Disney's Moana, I don't know if you've seen it. I've seen it 27 times, but I don't know if you've seen the movie, but in the movie, the whole premise is that there is an island that's living in their Isaiah chapter 8 kind of moment. They are living in a time of depression, anxiety, and fear because their island is slowly like being destroyed, and they don't really know why, and they don't know how to stop it. So a teenage girl named Moana sets out into the open ocean by herself to try to find a solution to the problem, but she very literally ends up dead in the water until a guy named Maui, who has the title of being a wayfinder, they meet. And I found out that a wayfinder is an actual profession. I don't know if you guys knew that, and I was just out of loop, but a wayfinder was a real profession back in the day. It kind of still is in some parts of the world, but a wayfinder is someone who would navigate the ocean without the use of a map or a compass. It was somebody who would use the stars and the sun and the moon. They would use ocean currents and water temperatures and wind and wave swells to navigate through the ocean to get from point A to point B. And Maui says this statement to Moana about wayfinding that I had never caught before. It definitely is going over my 7 and 5-year-olds' heads. It was going over my head the first 26 times, but I stumbled across it, and it reminded me of the wonder of a counselor we found in Jesus. Check this out. Check out how Maui describes wayfinding to Moana. I wrote this down. He says, it's called wayfinding, princess. It's not just sails and knots. It's seeing where you are going in your mind and knowing where you are based on where you've been. Yo, Jesus is our wayfinder. He is actually the only one who knows. We barely even know where we've been. We certainly have confusion about where we are right now, and we have no clue about the future, but Jesus knows the future based on the past and the present. He is the one that met the woman at the well and canceled out the shame of her past, who cleared up the chaos and the confusion of her present and launched her into a future with living water boiling up inside of her to reveal to her that he is the Messiah. So church, why do we keep paddling around the ocean on our own when we got a wonder of a counselor? We've got a wayfinder, not only in our back pocket, but beating inside of our chests. Why are we still paddling around, fighting the waves as if we've got all the answers, as if we know the way? We don't even know where we've been, let alone where we're going. We're just paddling around trying to work our way out of the current. We're just paddling around trying to earn enough money to get out of it and get to safety. We're trying to get enough degrees or get good enough grades or have the right relationships. All the while, we're just fighting against a current, going in circles. Why do we think we know the way? What we need is a wayfinder. Someone who knows where we've been, sees where we are, and knows how to lead us home. Again, Isaiah 9, verse 1, "Nevertheless, that time of darkness and despair will not go on forever. The land of Zebulun and Naphtali, they're going to be humbled. It's still going to be hard, but there will be a time in the future when Galilee of the Gentiles, which lies along the road that runs between the Jordan and the sea, will be filled with glory. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in a land of deep darkness, a light will shine." Church, first, we have to stop paddling around by our own will, by our own power, by our own wisdom, trying to get our way through the life and through the darkness and through the chaos. All we got to do is meet Jesus at the well. He's a wonder of a counselor. He's the Lord of heaven's armies. He knows the way, so meet with him. Talk to him. Listen to him. Read his word. I've kind of been in this weird habit lately. I'm a bad sleeper. If I wake up in the middle of the night, my head starts spinning. Anybody do that? My head starts spinning, my heart starts pumping, then I'm awake from 2 a.m. to 4 a.m., not being able to fall back to sleep based on whatever Isaiah chapter 8 thing happened in my life that day. So recently, I've just started in the middle of the night taking walks around my neighborhood, talking to Jesus. If you see me on your Ring doorbell, it's not weird. I'm just meeting Jesus at a well, okay? But I've started realizing that if I just lay in bed and I spin and my mind keeps going, all I'm trying to do is rely on my own wisdom and my own will, and I'm just paddling in circles around the ocean, fighting the wave, fighting the rapids, fighting the current, when I have a wonder of a counselor, and sometimes all you got to do is meet with him. Sit, listen to his voice at the beach. Seek him out when you're in your car. Spend time in his word. We have a wonder of a counselor that also happens to be the Lord of heaven's armies. Why would we not lean on him instead of leaning on our own understanding and our own knowledge? Stop paddling, start leaning. And then Isaiah 9, verse 7 again. His reign and its peace will never end. He will rule with fairness and justice from the throne of his ancestor David for all eternity. Because the passionate commitment of the Lord of heaven's armies will make this happen. I think when we stop paddling and start leaning, I think we'll actually find that we can trust Jesus more than you can trust any patient-client confidentiality in the world. I think you'll find that Jesus really is who he claims to be. I think you'll find that you can trust the wonder of a counselor with your time, with your energy. I think you'll find that you can trust the mighty God with your plans, with your past, with your present, with your future. I think you'll find that you can trust the everlasting Father with your family, that you can even trust him with your life because he is the Prince of Peace. We have to stop paddling, start leaning, and when we do, church, I think we'll find everything that we've ever been looking for. I think we'll find that you can trust Jesus, that he's got this and he's got you. In that moment, I think you'll hear the sneakers hit the floor. I think you'll hear the roar ripple throughout the darkness of the Pride Lands. I think you'll hear the jet engine kick into gear with the hero ready to step in. I think you'll hear the sword being pulled out of the sheath, that we now know that the king is alive. And as long as the king, that's the Lord of heaven's armies, is alive, this darkness will not last forever. I don't care if it's chaos, depression, anxiety, disease. Jesus is alive and he will end it. So take heart, church. Stop paddling. Start leaning, start trusting. Because Jesus, he's got you, and he's got all of this. So today, maybe you haven't been in the habit of leaning. Today we get a chance to take communion together. And maybe for the first time this week, you get to lean on the cross. Maybe for the first time this week, we get to acknowledge that Jesus is the author and the perfecter of our faith. That his cross can hold the weight of our sin, the weight of our shame, the weight of our past, the weight of the chaos and the darkness around us. So today, as we turn our attention towards communion, Let this be the first moment that we stop paddling and start leaning and trusting in the saving grace of the cross of Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Jesus, I know you said, to the Samaritan woman at the well, I know you told her that you were the Messiah, but then you proved it a couple years later. Dying on the cross. Yes, you're a wonder of a counselor. Yes, you're a mighty God. Yes, you're an everlasting Father. Yes, you're the Prince of Peace, but you're also the Savior of the world, the Savior of my soul. So Jesus, we come to you today in the context of our Isaiah chapter 8 moments. We come to you in our darkness. We come to you in our chaos, our disease, our fear, our depression, our anxiety, the weight that's on our shoulders that we feel like we can't get off. And we lay it at the feet of your cross today. And we say, Jesus, we trust you. So we take this bread now. Just remember the life that you gave up, that made a way for us to walk into the light. Go ahead and take the bread together now. Jesus, in the same way we take this cup, that we remember the blood that you poured out, that nobody took from you, that you poured out, that now flows in our veins, that you are a wonder of a counselor that now beats inside of our chest. Go ahead and take the juice together now. Jesus, we admit we've been paddling around in the darkness. We are literally dead in the water, but starting today, Jesus, we are going to lean on you. We are going to trust in you. Jesus, it's always been about you. It's always been for you. It's always been because of you. But right now in this moment, we acknowledge that you are an unimaginably great counselor. You are our way finder. So God, lead us in the way everlasting. On behalf of us all, Jesus, we're leaning on you and we trust in you. We love you the most. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
That our prayer this morning that you meet with us here again and again. Father, we pray that as we go out from the service today and into this week, that we just be reminded of that we have your presence with us each day. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. All right. Well, thank you everyone for being here today. If you're looking for prayer, we have our prayer leaders up front. Feel free to come forward. If you're looking to get connected or to give, you can take your phone and tap it on the tag on the chair in front of you. And other than that, I just hope that you have a great day, and we will see you next weekend.